So welcome everybody. As you know, we normally start 15 minutes late, but there's a very, and everybody's biology is geared to this. So you will find people will start arriving soon, but there's such a dense schedule that we thought it would be much better to use the time, especially the time for those of you who are here. I'm Mark Wigley, the Dean of the school here, and just words of welcome to what I think is an amazing conference, and I'm super grateful to Clara for organizing this conference, but also, let's say, organizing the rethinking that this conference implies. If you think about the logic of the conference, it's not a typical conceptual structure. Clara is a wonderful member of the urban planning program here, but is also director of the newly formed Latin Lab, which is a kind of research unit devoted to thinking the question Latin thinking that which is already a question, Latin. And you can see that in the organization of this conference. What I find revolutionary and provocative in the organization of the conference is it seems that in this event, Latin America is not treated as a territory. I mean, the gesture here, or even a multiplicity of territories, not even, let's say, a complication of the question of territory. So on the one hand, in this conference, the question of Latin America seems to be a very specific local question, as you can see in each paper being very specific in space and time. But it's also a little bit reverse engineered, that the way it challenges the question of identity and territory forces all of our disciplines to think at a general level about what it means, these concepts of territory, identity, and so on. So I like the way that it almost exploits Latin America, one more time, by turning the question Latin America around and reflecting, bouncing back from what you think might be the territory, Latin America, to force all questions of territories to be reassembled and rethought, all questions of identity. So in this sense, I think it's it adds an enormous level of dignity to this question, Latin America, by saying Latin America is the teacher in this case, but the teacher is not over there where you can point. It's here already in all locations at all times. And I think this is a very sophisticated conceptual regime, which is then supported by an extremely sophisticated and interesting group of people. So you could have ignored everything I've said, and actually I recommend that, because Clara will now explain what the conference is really about. But independently of this, why I think it's a very interesting event, this will be an enormous pleasure, this conference, and I think pleasure is really the secret glue at the heart of good research. And I cannot thank Clara enough for the intelligence and care with which she and her colleagues have curated this event. So thank you to Clara, and welcome to your stage that you have made for 2 days. Very, very dense. There is more or less bad food and bad coffee and everything very close at hand, bathrooms and so on, but the real event is here, Clara.
Thank you very much, Mark, for your kind introduction, and thank you and welcome everybody to New York and to Colombia and to this conference. I need to express my phenomenal gratitude to Dean Mark Wigley and also Dean David Hinkle and many other people in the school, Ben Protsky, Lucia Hadas, Halashian, John Ramallo and his staff, Janet Foster, Alejandro de Castro Mazzarro, Milagros Lecuona, Andrea Marpillero Colomina, Emmanuel Pratt and Janet Reyes and staff. I also want to thank people from the Institute for Latin American Studies, most particularly Teresa Aguayo and Tomas Trebat, and then people from the Center for the Study of Ethnicity and Race, most particularly its director, Frances Negron Montaner, and the staff. So the Dean, I think, explained it very well, what this conference was about. But let me tell you it once more. This conference, Transnational Latin Americanisms, Liminal Places, Cultures, and Powers, Here, There, aims to explore transnational Latin American socio-cultural and spatial conditions across the globe and at different scales, from the gendered and racialized body to the national and transnational arenas. But what do we mean by transnational Latin Americanisms? When we use Latin Americanisms in plural, we purposefully implode, as the dean suggested, the notion of a unified, cohesive, or static Latin America and its corresponding singular identity, that is a way of being Latin American. Transnational Latin Americanisms are instances of that which can be defined as Latin American, which is in turn open to debate and transformation, that occur through societal relations spanning plurilocally, between and above the traditional container spaces of nation states without a clear headquarters or motherland. When we refer to liminal places, cultures, and powers, we wrestle with the transitional and unstable phase or condition of sensorial threshold, bare perceptibility, or in-betweenness of these places, cultures, and powers that we investigate. The ambiguous term here, there, reflects the new chronotopies or arrangements of time-space that are neither here nor there, but also are here and there. A multidisciplinary notion, transnationalism, is capturing the imaginaries of scholars that have found concepts such as international globalization or cosmopolitanisms too rigid to capture the fluxing and complex nuances of today's world. Trans is a prefix that means above, beyond, across, or transcending. In our interrelated world, the lives and practices of many individuals and communities often transcend the boundaries of particular localities within nation states. Transnationalism has come to signify the cross-border networks developed by localized communities routinely traveling or connecting to people abroad, and the ways in which the resulting networks link geographically distinct places into social fields. The process of inter, supra, renationalization, globalization, localization, diaspora building, and transnationalization contribute to the emergence of these new, dense, and vibrant societal spaces. Transnational social practices are unique in that they include multiple spaces of localization and articulation. At the same time, transnationalism is not necessarily about movement. Movement is not a prerequisite to participate in transnational practices. Transnationality also alludes to the transversal, transactional, translational, and transgressive aspect of contemporary behaviors and imaginations that are incited, enabled, and regulated by the changing logics of states and capitalism. Transnationalism also refers to the cultural specificities of global processes and the multi-sided dimensions of the practices of placemaking. The concept was first used in the economics literature to refer to movements of capital, commodity chains, and the impact of transnational corporations. It was then extended to international migration flows and the role in increasing transborder linkages through return visits and remittances. Not only does transnationalism reshape local realities, but local factors also mediate transnational practices, although the latter has been the focus of far less research, a condition that we aim to redress. The global and the local are blending in global context of sustained and evolving social practices that compose new chronotopes. The resulting networks or social fields bridge nation states and create hybrid social and cultural spaces. Within them, migrants reconstruct their national, racial, ethnic, and political identities as an adaptation to their fluid, multinational existences. Transnational migrants assume multiple identities as they go about their business of negotiating their position between and within nation states. Michael Peter Smith defines transnational urbanism as a cultural rather than a geographic metaphor. Smith also articulates a conceptual distinction between globalization and transnationalism. Discourses on globalization and transnationalism differ in the assumptions they make about the role of the state in the production and negotiation of power, knowledge, and subjectivity, which in turn shape meanings, identities, and social relations. Transnationalism, as different from globalization, captures the horizontal and relational nature of contemporary economic, social, and cultural processes, which stream across spaces and expresses their embeddedness in differently configured and reconfigured scales and regimes of power. Transnational discourses depict social relations as anchored in, but transcending, nation states. They emphasize the continuing yet reworked significance of borders, state policies, and national identities, while recognizing that they are often transgressed by media networks and social practices. Theories of transnationalism treat the nation state and transnational practices as interlocked, enmeshed, mutually constitutive social formations. Apadurai recognizes the special translocalities these processes produce, in which ties of marriage, work, business, and leisure weave together various circulating populations with kinds of locales. The multiple mobilities of different actors and their intersections have played a key role in constructing Latin America as an ever-shifting and dynamic transnational space. In the words of Arturo Escobar, it is crucial to recognize that Latin America is today a global reality. Latin America is literally the world over. As a result, a continuous process of construction and reconstruction of multiple places and identities around the world manifest different degrees of liminality, hybridization, and syncretism that include distinct Latin American traits. Similarly, the identities of Latin American individuals and collectives, while maintaining a different degree of Latin American core, often become more flexible, performative, and transnational. The conference explores the production and transformation of new and conventional types of spaces and socio-cultural and political engagements in a transnational arena. We aim to understand the different subfields of transnational living and acting subjects engage in and assess their individual, collective, institutional, and socio-spatial effectiveness and implications. We will also pay attention to the way in which subjected populations resist, adapt, or co-produce transnational projects deployed upon their communities. And in the process, transnational subjects occupying different positionalities here and there are shaped and reshaped. Latin Americanists from across the globe are examining this rich phenomena in a myriad of different contexts and scales, but their insights and findings have yet to be collectively considered. This conference brings into a creative dialogue scholars from the spatial sciences, including the disciplines that we represent here at GSAP, architects, preservationists, urban designers, urban planners, and geographers, and other complementary fields, anthropology, history, and sociology. Through case studies, speakers will explore different agents that are engaged in city-making practices. The conference explores Latin Americanness the world over and integrates into Latin American studies theoretical and methodological perspectives drawn from the interaction between the spatial fields and others. The encounter is prone to push the boundaries of knowledge in the cutting-edge era or area of transnationalism, but the intent is not only to advance theory, but also creative proposal making in the areas of policy, research, and pedagogy. Jackson, Crank, and Dwyer note that many transnational studies have underplayed the transformation of space. We want to reverse this condition. They put forth an expansive notion of transnational space, which we ascribe to in furthering our understanding of Latin Americanness. Their understanding of transnational space include, I quote, not just the material geographies of labor migration or the trading in transnational goods and services, but also the symbolic and imaginary geographies through which we attempt to make sense of our increasingly transnational world. Transnational space is complex, multidimensional, and multiply inhabited. People from various backgrounds enter its spaces with a whole range of investments and from various positionalities. They may occupy its spaces momentarily during the consumption of a meal, for example, or for a lifetime as members of ethnically defined transnational communities. They may have residual affinities to the transnational identities of earlier migrant generations or emerging identities as a result of their own current transnational experiences. End of quote. Bearing this notion of transnational space in mind, our examination of the social construction of Latin America under transnational dynamics is both a theoretical and political project that seeks to contribute to a deeper elucidation of its impact on policymaking, research, and teaching in our disciplines. Torres and Monson warns of that the tendrils of transnational forces are far-reaching and persistent, irresistibly stretching out to engulf even the most isolated corners of the world. The expansive and unintended ramifications of this project, that is, the ability to restructure seemingly remote, unattached places, provides a cautionary tale for all development initiatives. Inherent in our analysis is a critique of the current processes of global capitalist-driven development. Understanding Latin America as a transnational space provides insights into the power of global capitalism to expand geographically, to transform and commodify places, and to tighten its grips in all aspects of life. In doing so, globalization and capitalist development in Latin America have often exacerbated existing inequalities and created new uneven geometries of power and at multiple scales. These inequities involve not only power and economics, but are also evident in the subordination of local cultures, social structures, and environments. The instances of transnational Latin Americanisms discussed in this conference illustrate the complex web of actors and social relations occurring at multiple scales that construct spaces that either promote individual or collective empowerment or produce and reproduce inequalities between people, communities, regions, and nations. By examining the role of transnational forces in reshaping local realities in and about Latin America, it may be possible to heed the World Social Forum's claim that another world is possible, characterized by more equitable and sustainable development and a lot more spaces for solidarity. If another world is possible, then other Latin Americas are also possible, including transnational ones that incorporate us. Thank you. And I want to invite Professor Mabel Wilson to the podium, and she's going to be the moderator and discussant of the first panel. All of the speakers will have 20 minutes for their presentations. She will follow up with comments for 10 minutes and then open it up for discussion with all of you. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. And I would like to thank Clara for organizing an exceptional and timely conference. And I think really what she just laid out, particularly as I love the way she described this idea of Latin America as a global reality, and really brought forth the critical importance of thinking about transnationalism spatially. And so I think these papers in this particular panel really sort of speak, I think, to those critical questions in Clara's wonderful introduction. So to begin with, I will briefly introduce each speakers, and you can find longer biographies of the panel in the program. I'm delighted now to introduce the distinguished members of our first panel entitled Gender, Ethno-Race, and Image Making. As an assistant professor of community and regional planning at Iowa State University, Dr. Gerardo Sandoval's research and teaching focus on the intersection of economic and community development in both rural small towns and inner city neighborhoods in large metropolitan areas. He holds a PhD from the University of California, Berkeley in city and regional planning. Our next speaker, Dr. ZAIDA MUXI, obtained her PhD in architecture at the University of Sevilla, Spain in 2002. Since 2003, she has been a professor in the planning department at the Architecture School of Barcelona. She has published articles on urban development, architecture, and design, and has co-authored and contributed to numerous books on public-private spaces. Her doctoral dissertation, The Architecture in the Global City, was published by Gustavo Gili in 2004. As an associate professor of urban and regional planning at the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, Dr. Faranak Miraftab research interest concerns the social aspects of urban development. In particular, she is interested in how low-income groups and women access housing and basic urban services. Her research and teaching has spanned several countries, including Chile, Mexico, Canada, Australia, South Africa, and the United States. She received her doctorate in planning from the University of California at Berkeley. Closing our first panel will be Dr. Marcela Tovar. Dr. Tovar is a lecturer in the Latin American Studies program and the Anthropology Department at Queens College University as part of the CUNY system. She received her master's degree in urban development at the University College of London and obtained her PhD in anthropology at the New School for Social Research in New York. Please join me in welcoming our first panelist and presenter, Gerardo Sandoval. Thank you.
Okay, well, first I'd like to thank you for inviting me here today. I'll be discussing a case study of a small town in Iowa. When I say small, I mean a town that is made up of about 2,000 people. It's a town it's about 30 minute drive going west from the Mississippi River. So it's separating, the river separates Wisconsin and Iowa, if you're not familiar with it. So this area is, it's pretty much a town in the middle of nowhere, I would say. But it's a town that's at the confines of globalization and transnationalism. That's what really fascinates me about this little town. It's also a town that has received a lot of attention, local attention, attention from the state, national attention, and transnational attention, international attention, because it's a town where there was a large immigration raid that occurred about 2 years ago. It was the largest, one of the largest immigration raids in U.S. history. So about 400 workers were detained in this meatpacking plant in this town. What's interesting is that 350 of those workers were from Guatemala, and about 300 of those were from two very small villages in the highlands of Guatemala. So today I'll be discussing the impacts of that raid, the economic impacts, the social impacts, the cultural impacts of that raid in both spaces. So in the spaces of in Postville and also in the villages in Guatemala. So I'll get into some theory first and describe this notion of the immigrant's milieu how that relates to global small towns. Discuss a little bit about the issue of transnational urbanism, about town image making, and how these a lot of towns in Iowa are kind of celebrating the diversity that's been coming to their towns. But then within this celebration, there's this underlying conflict. Right, and that's the meatpacking industry and the restructuring that has occurred in the meatpacking industry. Then I'll finally discuss the impacts related to the broken transnational linkages in these towns. So this concept of the immigrant's milieu is something I've been developing. My dissertation was on a immigrant neighborhood in Los Angeles, an immigrant neighborhood that was able to withstand the pressures of large-scale redevelopment. And I argue that a key reason for that neighborhood's survival, which is very unusual in the field of planning, was that it had elements of this immigrant milieu. And basically, this is a milieu where immigrants create a social, political, and economic and cultural capital, where they develop these dynamic sense and dynamic institutions. They maintain a vibrant and dynamic sense of place. And having these types of characteristics provides them with influence and power over maintaining their sense of place. So when I moved to Iowa, I became interested in these small towns, right? And how these small towns had some of these characteristics, and how they were global towns, and they were able to transform those social and cultural landscapes. Claudia mentioned Michael Peter Smith. When I think about transnationalism, I think of transnational urbanism. So he defines it as a cultural metaphor. Right? It's a transnational space where social actors are materially connected to socioeconomic opportunities, political structures, and cultural practices that are found in different points in their transnational communication circuit. I would add that transnationalism is also definitely present in these in rural spaces, okay? And that's what I've been seeing in Iowa. Yeah. There's not all of those spaces are obviously transnational, but there are particular spaces within these rural communities that do maintain this these transnational linkages. Yeah. Now, this notion of image making at the town level is important. I got into this type of image making myself in this small town of Perry. Yeah. They also have a meatpacking industry. It's also a meatpacking town, and here they started to pretty much welcome immigrants. Right, they saw immigrants as a resource. A lot of what immigrants are doing is they're revitalizing the main streets of these towns that are seeing a lot of disinvestment that's occurring in these locations. So the towns, they really try to kind of celebrate that aspect of it. Okay? I mean, they try to incorporate that into the planning aspects, into different kind of cultural festivals. into the new story that's developing there. So for example, in Perry, if you look at the mural up there, that's the migration kind of history that of this town. And so this town had immigrants that came from Eastern Europe, then immigrants that came from the eastern portion of the United States, and then the Latino immigrants are the new immigrants. So that was part of the, you know, part of the story making. Now, this was a studio I conducted in the town where we try to figure out how to better integrate the Latino community into this space. And so when I say I got involved in this image making, I really did. It was kind of seen as a positive thing, right? Because we're trying to figure out how we can integrate these global spaces into the type of planning that occurs in these small communities. One of the things we did is we looked at different needs that the community has, right? And then we proposed a business incubator, some design sketches to better integrate them into public spaces. In a resource center. What this was supposed to do was it was supposed to kind of help the immigrants adapt to the town, right? And so that's that was one of the kind of the key kind of image making things that have occurred there. This town is Postville, okay? And Postville has had a lot of kind of cultural kind of clashes throughout the years. The meatpacking plant is a kosher meatpacking plant. It's was the largest kosher meat, one of the largest kosher meatpacking plants in the United States. So when the Jewish community moved into this area, there was a lot of tension as well. Now they were relying on cheap immigrant labor as well, so that also caused a lot of tension in the community. But there was also a lot of positive aspects to it, right? So the town, as you can see, their image is, you know, it's kind of hometown to the world. They try to celebrate that aspect of it, okay? The different kind of the cultural aspects of it. The Latino community there also started investing in a lot of the on Main Street, right? So they were the key investors that would start opening up new businesses. I think there was about 4 grocery stores before the raid. There was also a couple of clothing stores, about 4 different restaurants as well. This is a Guatemalan bakery that also opened there, and you know, having these types of community investment in these towns that are seeing a lot of disinvestment, it was very important for these little towns. So immigrants were, you know, were seen as a very positive aspect and a positive contribution to these communities. Okay, this map shows the locations of all the meatpacking plants in Iowa. Those are the blue dots. Okay, it also shows the different percentages of where Latinos are located. The red dots there are the 2 immigration raids that have occurred in the last 4 years. So one occurred in Marshalltown. And there's Postville. You can see it there by the Mississippi River. So it's in the eastern north part of Iowa. Okay. So what's occurring here is that the meatpacking industry is restructuring the landscape in Iowa. And since the meatpacking industry has gone from a unionized industry to one that's now dependent on cheap immigrant labor, it's attracting a lot of Latinos to these towns. That's the economic kind of engine behind what's occurring there. I took this picture in one of the meatpacking plants. So this picture shows where all the different workers are coming from. So it's a very diverse kind of, you know, transnational labor force there. This is in the Perry meatpacking plant. Here I've just drawn. I've identified and kind of drawn where some of those transnational links are associated with. So in Perry, most of the workers come from the state of Michoacán. That's in Mexico. In Marshalltown, they come from one particular town, and that's Villachuato. Now that town is a larger town. Marshalltown is about 30,000 people, so it's a small town. Now in Postville, most of the workers, as I said, most of the immigrants came from 2 small villages in Guatemala. And I'll get into more of the specifics of that. So the raid occurred in May of 2008. And the raid was conducted in a pretty kind of brutal fashion. So it made, like I mentioned, international headlines. And it pretty much overnight this destroyed the Guatemalan community that was adapting there. This image is of the bakery that I showed you before. The bakery went out of business about 4 months ago. It actually burned down about two months ago. I think symbolically, this is the perfect image of what occurred to the Guatemalan community in this global space. It was basically, like I mentioned, destroyed overnight. So some of the economic impacts, if you go to Postville now, you will see maybe one restaurant that remains. All of the other businesses have closed off because their market was pretty much taken overnight. Another key aspect to all this are the gender issues around everything. There were 50, I think there was 56 people that were not deported but were detained under house arrest. They were monitored by those GPS devices that you see on the ankles. Out of those, only two of them were males. All of them were women, because the government didn't know what to do with them, since they had dependents here in the U.S. They didn't know some of those dependents were U.S. born as well. So that they really became the symbol for the raid, the women there. And one of the key issues that I'm uncovering with one of my colleagues that I'm working around this around the kind of the gender issues is that, you know, when they were first detained, the women really felt kind of disempowered, and they, you know, they weren't allowed to work, right? So they lived off of the charity of the church, pretty much. As the process went along, and as this case became kind of internationally known, and as they started to become the symbol of the raid, they really felt this sense of empowerment within all of this, and they felt like they were protecting their families, you know, and that was their kind of, you know, their call to action. And now there are 16 of them remaining. They're still pretty much under house arrest. The rest of them went back to Guatemala. I'll talk briefly about the case in Guatemala itself, and this is where the transnational aspects are really become evident. Okay? Even though this was a very small town, the links were very strong. The two towns are El Rosario and Calderas, and they're located in the altiplano of Guatemala. This is El Rosario. When I interviewed a lot of the women, they were very interested in seeing some of my photos, because they couldn't recognize this place. 5 years ago, this area was made out of sugarcane. All of the buildings were sugarcane buildings. In a four-year period, the structures were transformed from sugarcane structures to structures made out of concrete. Okay. This just gives you an idea of how some of them look. The type of work that people did here was basically subsistence agriculture, right? With the remittances that were being reinvested in this area, that opened up a new forms of economic development. So they started a new kind of construction industry. Some of the workers started buying up their own plots of land and using that as economic development strategies. This image here shows, it's pretty drastic, because this is in the same village, and this village has about 500 people. Okay, so one side of the street, this probably shows where you know, people that didn't really have family members in Postville, whereas the other side, you know, drastically shows people that did. The government, and this is within the literature of transnationalism, you see a lot of the remittances that are the local governments get really involved in trying to invest and use some of those remittances as a resource. Right. So here they cleaned up the river that was polluted there. They opened up they paved roads, right? So they opened up new transportation systems into the town. They built this bridge. The school here, that's a plaque dedicated to the mayor, but it's basically the school went from being a a two-room type of shack to now being a two-story elementary school with 8 classrooms. Okay? So the local government there really saw the personal investment in these remittances and started to invest in the community. Before they immigrated, there was one store there. Now there was about 5 different little stores that people also started investing through these remittances. That's a picture of the school and some more. You can see some of the paved roads there. So I think the key here, I've been able to calculate how much money was going into these two villages, and there's about $40,000 per month that was being pumped into this community. That's a huge resource, right? And that's why within just a 4-year period, these communities were really able to kind of take advantage of those resources and build their basic infrastructure. And now they have running water now and some electricity. Some of the structures there are 2 stories high. Now, after the raid, everything stopped overnight. All that the flows of remittances were no longer there. Right? So a lot of the structures now are basically at a standstill. And what I'm trying to now understand, I'm still in pretty much in the beginning stages of this project. And I've done field work in Postville. I've also done field work in Guatemala. This semester, I'll be finishing my field work in Postville. And then I'll go back to Guatemala in the summer. And what I'm really trying to understand are the impacts of this type of, this type of raid on both of these communities. And I think what this case study shows, and it really shows that, first of all, there's a real resources, right? And these remittances are obviously very beneficial for different communities. That the transnational linkages are obviously very, very strong and with each other. But there's also that other kind of darker side of transnationalism, and that's the side of dependency, right? As you can see, once the remittances kind of dried up, well, then everything came to a standstill. So now the questions I'm working with relate to issues of sustainability and issues of how you could have taken these types of resources and reinvested them in a different manner, and maybe by creating alternative forms of economic development or other housing structures that people could have used more and so forth. This picture is of a community-based organization in this area. And I want to leave with that because I think it kind of shows the hope for the future that this is not, even though this has been played as a case that this kind of shows a lot of the problems with this type of immigration reform that has occurred. It also shows some hope for the future related to how we can better kind of harness these types of opportunities. So if during the question and answer session, I really would appreciate some feedback on the project. So, thanks.
Our next panelist will be Dr. ZAIDA MUXI.
First of all, thank you to Clara for inviting me to be part of this panel. I'm going to explain part of a research that we are doing in the School of Barcelona, trying to analyze the use of public space and the access to housing for immigrant people, especially the use that women do of the public space. And we focus on this presentation is focused especially in one neighborhood that is in Terrassa. I'm going to explain a little further. So the first thing I want to say is that the immigrant population is generally a very diverse collective, and we propose that points in common can be drawn from analysis that take into account other major characteristics beyond country of origin, such as economic situation and education level. Through observation of groups in public space, especially squares, it is possible to identify aspects related to social status and to gender roles assigned by their original and adopted cultures. So, our research is focused, what I'm going to present, in a neighborhood that has a high proportion of immigrants among their population. It was a renewed immigration as of the mid of the 90s brought in immigrants from other nations, whereas the majority of the early population of these neighborhoods had come from intense domestic immigration in Spain following the end of the Spanish Civil War, especially in the 50s. So these are the neighborhoods we have analyzed. I'm going to explain this neighborhood, La Maurina in Terrassa. And was, as I say, this Terrassa is a second level city in the metropolitan area of Barcelona. It's a former industrial city. And this is La Maurina neighborhood. As I said, is a neighborhood. La Maurina is a neighborhood that their population is mainly from outside Catalonia, from Andalusia and south of Spain. And from the end of the 90s, many migrants came to live in this kind of neighborhood. Migrants from outside the European region came to live in this neighborhood. And here you have some statistics about Spanish situation and Catalonia in particular. That is, it's very the Spanish situation is very particular because it's a new thing to have migrants from outside the country, and Spain was used to be a country that expelled people outside Spain. As me, for example, I came from Argentina, but my father and my mother came from Spain, and now I came back to Spain, so it's a kind of ping pong. And the thing that is really, really impressive is how quickly was this changing in Spain, and especially there are a few regions that are more intense, and one of these regions is Catalonia. Here you have the numbers. From 3% of the population from outside the European Union in 2000, in the middle, the average of Catalonia is 15%. And this neighborhood we are going to analyze is between 11 and 36% of population came from outside Europe. So there are some neighborhoods that are much more dense in immigrants. Or for example, in the city center, there's a neighborhood, El Raval, which is the population in the center of Barcelona, which population, 46% of the population came from outside Europe. So, and all that happened in the last 10 years. So this is La Maurina neighborhood. This is the area with between 26-36% of immigrants, and this is the figure for Moroccan and from American immigrants that are the most numerous from the Moroccan and the Latin American immigrants. And this, later I'm going to explain more this graphic, but this is the percentage of men between women. For example, this the dark area, the dark blue, is between 160 and 173 men for 100 women. And this is majority, it's the same area that is inhabited by Moroccan population. But in the case of Latin America population, we have more a Latin American population where the men proportion is less than 100. So we have more women living here alone, and in the case of the Moroccan, it's more men. This is very important because that make a big difference between the women population. In the case of the Moroccan women, they came after the men, when the men was installed in Catalonia and they got the legal situation, the women came to get married and to have a family. In the case of Latin American women, many of them came alone and they maintain herself in Catalonia, but also with her work, she maintained her family in the place of origin. So it's really different, the situation of women from both, from these countries, or these areas, not countries. And that's important because our work, that was a research work that links the direct observation and experience of the place, we're trying to look for the women in the public space and trying to understand why and for and with they use the public space. And although there are a lot of women from Latin America in this neighborhood, it's hardly it's really difficult to find women from Latin America in the daily life in that neighborhood. And that's why, because they work outside in the productive work, so they came at late at night and they go out early in the morning, and the Moroccan women stay in the neighborhood because they work for the family, only for the family. And that's the same that happened with the women from Latin America is what happened with the men, the young men from the North of Africa. It's difficult to see them in the public space during daily days, but during the weekend, that changed. The women from Latin America, also during the weekend, they don't use the public spaces in this neighborhood because the common trend in this group of Latin American migrants that were alone, not with the family, or some with family, but not they don't live in this neighborhood. They get together in another places of the metropolitan area. They don't do social relations in the neighborhood. So I explain. I want to read, but finally I don't read. So what we do here in this neighborhood, we went to this, this is the first space we analyze. So what I'm going to explain is this public space square that is surrounded by the school, the commercial center, a supermarket, and also this street is a very important and commercial street, this one. So this is a place where people from all the neighborhood get together, especially because of the school. And here we can find usually many people from, many women, but especially from north of Africa. And what we do in this direct observation of the public space, we're trying to mix a kind of quantification of the statistics, the data. We want to mix these data with the observation and with the quality, with kind of quality observation. So we went to the place and we observed how it used and when and why. And you have this, we made this kind of plans. This is a immigrant person, this is a local person, and here we put a letter that means young people, adults, kids with independent, with some freedom in movement, or kids that are dependent of others, people from the third around 16 and people older, and what are they doing in these spaces? And we observe this is the spaces in different days, different hours, and also with different climatology, so we can understand why and how the spaces are used. And here, and the different, for example, this is during the morning, going to school, waiting for the bus, or at the midday in another square, it's not so used for the, especially for women or for kids. And well, and we try to relate the observation of these spaces and the people who is using it with the daily life requirements, but also with the shape of the space, because this, in this case, this is a big square with the facilities giving face to this space. Also, it has playgrounds and places for different people. The other spaces, in public spaces in the neighborhood, are less inclusive for both reasons, because of the designing of the place and also because of the uses that are surrounding the area, and also because of the homogeneity of the people who live around these spaces. This is the other one. That is La Maurinia Square. It's surrounded by a housing area, the original housing types of this neighborhood, that is self-built houses. That was made during the 60s by these migrant people from Andalusia, especially. And so we have a very homogeneous surrounding, and also the shape or the topography of the square is not very friendly, especially for women. So the women only use this space to cross if they need to go to their house or something, especially, but not as a place to stay. This is the analysis of this space. Is majority men, and the women, in any case, they use more the limits of the space, or if they need to cross like this to cross the square coming back. But that changed during the weekend, where some festivals are doing this square. So here, people from also from the local people and the people from Morocco, they get together in this space, and here appears the young men from Morocco that till now we couldn't see them in the public space, not during the daylight hours. You can find them more at the end of the day or at the night, but during the day, no. And here they came with their kids, and the women came later. Moroccan women came later with the small kids. And when we find the Latin American, some Latin American women during the weekend, in the morning, Sunday morning, talking in this case with a man from the local autochthonous, but as I say, mostly the women from Latin America went to meet other. Other Latin American groups, especially the Ecuadorians ones, in some places outside this neighborhood. And these are the four mainly areas for the meeting or the gathering of this group of, especially Ecuadorian from Ecuador groups. This is in La Mina. This is in the front of on the beach. This is a small square in the middle of the city, and this is a big open space with no quality or no design at all, but where the people, it's very interesting because during the weekend, this collective go there and make a real place by transforming it with their uses. For example, these are the La Mina Square. This is an original housing area of Gypsy people. This is the other place in La Marbella Park, in front of the sea. This is Parque del Escorchador, in the center of Barcelona. And this other is this big void here, this empty space, very near to the Camp Nou and the university area. This is the Barcelona Football Club Stadium. And here we have this area, and we see during the weekend how is being getting into life, this empty space, by a lot of people from Ecuador who came here and create many different spaces to play volleyball or to football or to have they create also places to have land. You see here all these are the bars, the restaurants, and the people playing volleyball here. And it's very interesting. Also here we can see the gender roles, and some women play volleyball, but most of them are engaged with the food work. We can see here how they domesticate this empty space. And this is the other space. We went with Clara last year here. It's La Mina Park. Till this occupation by Ecuadorian population, this space was not used at all because it was a kind of neglected area or dangerous or stigmatized area in La Mina because of the origin of the population. But now this park is really being used by this migrant from Ecuador. And here was in the same place two women from Arabic Muslim women that were alone. So this is a big difference. When you see the women also in the neighborhood we study or in another place, the Muslim women, you see them working in their reproductive task, but it's hardly difficult to find them in bigger groups. Totally different what happened with the women from Latin America. Also because of the language, this is another thing that I wrote in the paper, that the language is really a big deal, and for the Latin American migrants, this is an easy way to get into the society. Although in Catalonia we speak two languages, but it's not a problem really for the people who came from Latin America. And I don't know, I'm going to read, but maybe it's too. I'm trying to read. As a conclusion, transnationalism and gender. Certain considerations can be posed in interpreting the phenomenon of contemporary immigration. Unlike in other eras, modern immigrants can be thought of as transnational because they maintain multiple connections with their countries and families of origin, using modern communication technologies such as telephone, email, remittance of money, and other items. One of the features of transnationalism is living in two places and expanding and connecting with a broad social realm. This situation, deriving from communication technologies, changes the classical notion of integration in the local culture. The process of this experience of dual belonging, sometimes triple or quadruple, depending on family fragmentation stemming from immigration to various places on the planet, and hence virtually sharing other local situations based on other family members' experience, produce more unpredictable process of acculturation. This unpredictable situation is confirmed in observation of other collectives or even within a single collective of immigrants showing different behavior in public relations in the space. The situation is fairly complex since it depends on many individual issues that may relate to the themes raised in this paper, but also to each person's immigration project. There is a big basic difference in individuals' behavior depending on whether their project is to work in order to make money to send back to the country of origin and return in better economic condition, or if their idea is to establish themselves in the adopted country for a variety of reasons, which beyond work may relate to their own attainments or the desire to start a family. Going deeper into the specificities of use of urban space, there are aspects on which we could generalize and which we wish to maintain, insofar as it is not the difference in origin that makes a significant difference of, in greater or lesser use of these spaces. There is no dimension of transnationality that conditions this. There has been a turnover from the local immigrant worker population to a Latin American and Moroccan immigration in the cases studied, with similar dwelling conditions and also similar use, although with certain shades of difference of public space, which allow us, from our observation, to get beyond stereotypical ideas, such as Moroccan women tend to stay in their homes, etc. While taking into account the context and the type of use we refer to, we can say that in terms of visible and non-visible uses, in this case, there is a similarity with uses made by autochthonous persons. Young and middle-aged Latin American women who work long hours outside their homes reproduce in the urban space the same dynamics as Spanish women working long hours to maintain their families. That is to say, they may be invisible in their residential surroundings, where those who are visible are persons who aid in making their work life compatible with caring from the home and children, as is the case today of many Spanish families where grandparents care for their grandchildren. In Mediterranean cities during the bulk of the years, the climate favors being outside and allow leisure activities to take place in squares or parks. On the other hand, applying the concept of gender to immigration implies talking a series of fundamental aspects and looking at the countries of origin and destination. The roles of women and men, the division of salaried work and domestic work, men's and women's access to resources, the portion of cost and benefits going to men and women, etc. In the analysis of migration, inclusion of the perspective of gender along with ethnic group and social class implies a step forward in better understanding and interpreting the migratory movement of women and in developing policies geared to women immigrants that do not end up reinforcing sexist stereotypes and hindering their possibilities for integration and autonomy. The profound diversity among immigrants' women does not prevent them from sharing certain common characteristics. One is the void they leave behind upon immigrating, a void that is very difficult to fill. On leaving their family group, must reorganize in order to survive. Grandmother, daughter, sisters-in-law, always other women, will take charge of family needs, following the pattern of sexual division of labor. Another shared characteristic is the difficulty they find in joining the work world. The difficulty is in finding work does not depend only on their nationality, but on a series of factors including original, social and economic status, length in their state in the adapted country, family situation, age, work experience in the country of origin, and above all, the gender relation of each collective. That is to say, employment insertion is conditioned by a specific factor of each woman, but also a factor related to the companies that hire them and by the legal framework. Even so, the vast majority join the labor market in occupations considered marginal, without a contract, part-time, with lower than standard wages, insecure and precarious jobs. It can be said that many immigrant women going through the back door of domestic service and caretaking, but also through the door of invisibility. Although not all immigrant women are in the same position for accessing the job market, they are subject to the worst working conditions and suffer gender discrimination as do autochthonous women, added to which is discrimination as foreigners. In any event, we can speak of discrimination produced by the sum of disadvantages of being a woman, being an immigrant, being poor, and being non-white. Ultimately, the use of public space by women is more related to or conditioned by gender roles, owned and adopted, than by their status as immigrant. Hence, urbanism, both in terms of urban design and of planning, must be conceived from the standpoint of inclusion and taking into account the gender perspective, from the stage of diagnosis through realization of projects and their subsequent evaluation. This paper proposes the analysis and understanding of use of public space so as to be in the position to develop an urbanism based on a close-up view of everyday relationship spaces.
Thank you. Our next presentation will be from Faranak Mirafstad.
Thank you very much. I want to thank Clara and colleagues and others who helped to make this conference possible and for inviting me. In this presentation, I will be talking about a dramatic social spatial change in a small Illinois town called Beerstown. It has about 6,000 to 7,000 people in population that in the last 15 years has changed from an all-white sundown town to a multicultural, multilingual, and multiracial town with about 30% of its population foreign-born. I don't know if you're familiar with sundown town, but that is a terminology that James Lowen, historical sociologist, created to describe towns in the north of United States that were putting signs of intimidation for African Americans, saying that don't stay here when the sun goes down. So they could work there, but by the time that sun goes down, they had to leave the town and stay elsewhere. So Beerstown, Illinois was one of those towns, was one of the sundown towns of Illinois. I believe there are thousands of them documented across the United States by James Lowen. So in this town, we see in the matter of from census of 1990 to 2000, there was 3,500% change in population of immigrants or foreign-born, basically. This change has been due to labor recruitment practices of its meatpacking company, Cargill Meat Solutions. Cargill slaughters and packs more than 18,000 hogs per day by its 1,700 workers on the production floor. It's one of the most productive, I mean, the level of production of this plant in terms of efficiency is highest in the Cargill Corporation. In this river town, 40 miles outside Springfield, as a local site of global capital accumulation, is intensely connected to multiple locations around the globe. This is not only through corporations' production processes, but also through people's translocal livelihood strategies that stretch from Latin America to West Africa and to Alaska. In many ways, this transnational community is more connected to these faraway global locations than it is to the four-hour-away Chicago. To understand this complex social space, I have relied on a multi-sited global ethnography. I started the work in 2004, and I have completed the Beerstown portion of the project, a field research, just last year. It took me 5 years to be able to break into the community. It's multi-sited in that I'm going to follow the immigrants to the locations of their origin. I have done the Mexico part of the project a summer ago, and this summer I'm hoping to go to Togo, where most of the West African immigrants come from. Well, I could have talked about this project, the larger project, in many different ways. I could have focused on logic of capital and exploitation of labor and focus on that side of it. Or I could have focused on transnational families, how the reproduction of labor in Mexico or in Togo is really makes it possible for the corporation to have such a highly exploitative and highly hazardous job performed by lower wage than average manufacturing wages. But instead, I'm going to focus on three points. Firstly, I want to get across that immigration patterns have changed in the last decade or more. Since 1990s, really, there has been documentation that immigrants, there is an increase or growth of migration to non-traditional destinations, and that includes Midwest and small towns like what GERARDO was sharing with us. So there is a non-traditional destinations, meaning not to the gateway states like California, Texas, Arizona, but rather places like Arkansas, Iowa, Illinois. Secondly, I would like to get across that it is important to look at intersectionalities of race and immigration, looking at not immigration alone, but how does it interact with race. And also the racialized histories of immigrants is very important in understanding the complexity of these processes when these immigrants arrive to these locations that do not have experience with diverse populations. And I'm hoping that in doing so, in revealing talking about local trans-local connections between these immigrants in local places, racialized local histories, and also their communities of origin, I could reveal the complexities and also the agency and not only the diversity of immigrant populations, but also their agency and how they renegotiate the relationships, the social and interracial relationships in the communities that they arrive. So that is basically the outline of the project also. I will very briefly talk about the immigration patterns, and I'm not going to go into detail of it, but I think the two points are important. For example, that Beardstown is part of a larger demographic trend. Between 1990 and 2000, for example, Hispanic immigrant population increased by 83% in Midwest, right? That is highly proportional increase that has been higher than any other region in the United States. So the proportion of increase in Midwest has been higher than the proportion of increase for example, California. And also, if we look at the African immigrants, we see that there has been an increase by 60% in the Midwest compared to 29% in the Northeast, 37% in the West, and 49% in the South. So West Africans, or African immigration in general, it has been documented that since 1990, there has been a growing, an increase in the proportion of immigrants from Africa coming to the United States. It's higher than the transatlantic immigration by Africans by their ancestors that were enslaved, right? So the number of immigrants that have arrived since 1990 to the United States is higher than the number of Africans that were brought to the United States as a slave. So this increase since 1990 is very important, and a lot of that concentration of where these new African immigrants go is to the non-traditional destinations. And the new Hispanic immigrants also are heading for non-traditional destinations. That includes rural areas and Midwestern states. I'm not going to go to all this detail. If you don't take my word, then I could give you the documentation that these are the census. It's true, because I don't want to spend more time on numbers. It's something that I don't really like much. I use them, but I don't want to spend time on them. Okay, this is like a map of Illinois, and the darker spaces that are all these rural counties that show they have a greater concentration of immigrants in them. And this data is important because it shows percentage of change from 2000 to 2007. We see that in urban areas for African population, was 95% increase, but in rural areas was 239% increase. So I think this should convince you that this is a larger trend, what we see in Beardstown. Now, the reasons for it are several. Rural industrialization has been very important. The decision by meat corporations to move, not only meat, but also agricultural industry, to move to rural areas where they can be closer to sources of production, where they can use the desperate municipalities that are looking for sources of employment, so they are giving all sorts of bonuses to industry, like Cargill, for example, got 10, 20 years of tax-free zone, so they could just, you know, move their plant there, create jobs, and not pay taxes to municipalities. So they want to take advantage of non-unionized or harder to unionize workers that are weaker than urban centers. In rural areas, the municipalities are more kind of accommodating of these industries, and they are going to be closer to the sources of material they need, whether it's agriculture or animal that they use. So rural industrialization is a move from 1970s that industries, agricultural and meat-related industries, food-related industries move to rural areas. It's tighter border control that basically that families, immigrants, especially Mexican immigrants, cannot cross the border back. And so movements have gone from a circular movement, which they could work and then go back home to their families or leave part of the family back home. They can't cross as easily. Therefore, it has changed to a linear, if you want to say. They are settling. And if you want to settle, then you look for somewhere that is less under surveillance of rates and also cheaper to stay. And in that sense, again, Midwest becomes more attractive. And lower living costs in Midwest, like we said. So these are the kind of factors that have contributed to the new trends we see in move of the immigration or increase in immigration to Midwest. Most research, however, on multiculturalism has been focusing on large metropolitan centers. Although the demographic trend has changed, we really don't have new and systematic studies of what is happening in these rural small towns that are receiving these immigrants, because most of our understandings are theorized based on the patterns and behavior or observations that we make in large cities and metropolitan centers that have had a history of immigrants, you know, diverse populations in them. So in understanding, so this study, I'm hoping that it could contribute to this shortcoming in scholarship, both in planning and otherwise. What are the interracial, social, and spatial relations that unfold in these emerging multicultural, multiracial small towns? That's one question. And secondly, what are the specificities of immigrants' experiences? Right. So I'm hoping that through the stories I will share, we could see at least begin a conversation about these two aspects, these two questions. To answer that and reveal the specificities of immigrants' experience, I want to take you to the parking lot of Walmart in Beardstown, the first place that I encountered this amazingly multicultural community, and I came across them. And I will share the stories of two people, Jose from Mexico and Ellen from Togo. Jose arrived, was one of the first Mexican immigrants who arrived to Beardstown in early 1990s. He used to live in California, and with his wife, they were undocumented. They were arrested. His wife was arrested twice and sent back to Mexico and then came back, and they were tired of it. A cousin told him that there is a job in Midwest in Cargill. It's 12 months year-round with secure, you know, payments income, and they are always looking for workers. So he and his cousin got in the car and arrived to Beardstown. He filled out the forms, showed some sort of identity. Cargill didn't want to know where he got it, and he was not interested to say where he got it, so the deal was done. He got the job, but he did not have the possibility of housing, because Beardstown, as a small town that had not been prepared for rental, you know, properties or tenements, was not able to accommodate. Nor did he have money to pay for the initial deposit for the mobile homes that could be an alternative for him. So he tells me that he stayed in a mobile home, sorry, in his car with his cousin for 2 weeks, waiting for the first paycheck to arrive before he could go and rent a mobile home. Jose is also, after that, now it's a very different story. He has bought that, managed to buy that home, mobile home. He has also bought a home, regular home for himself, and he has a rental property that he's renting out to immigrants. So for him in the last 15 years has been really a big change, and his wife once told me, he said, Beerstown has been the dream of home ownership for somebody like her, that she never could imagine becoming a homeowner. Jose is also a third generation immigrant. His father, his grandfather was the first generation in his family that moved to US working while the wife and children were back in Mexico. His grandfather was part of the Mexican workers that built the railroad, part of that group. And then his father was an immigrant in US as part of the Braceros program, those who Mexicans who built the, basically worked as agricultural laborers in California and Washington. He is the third generation working, he and his siblings, they all work for the for Cargill and meatpacking and industry. He was the first one to arrive, and since he's arrived, he's brought 25 of his extended family from Michoacán, the state he's coming from. So it has kind of been a chain of his ability to bring the rest of the family. But the best part of the stories that he said was about the mother-in-law who managed to join them, and now while the 25 extended family that siblings and cousins and etc. he has, they all are working for Cargill, their children are taken care of by the mother-in-law because Cargill doesn't offer any childcare services for the workers. So in that sense, it's helping. Also, by having multiple members of his family working in US, it helps him that the burden of remittances is lower on him. There are several people who are sending money home. As we are talking in that parking lot, Ellen approaches us. Ellen greets Jose in Spanish, and that is interesting, catches my attention. I know Ellen from before, and then I realize that the connection is that Ellen's newborn child is taken care of by Jose's mother-in-law, who is taking care of other Mexican children. And that is how she has learned the language a little bit. Ellen, like many other, most other Togolese and West African immigrants in Beerstown, is highly educated. Actually, the surveys I did there, 54% of, or 54% of the people I talked to, West Africans working for Cargill I talked to in that town, have 4 years of college education or more. I've interviewed veterinarian doctors, human rights lawyer, sociology professor, mechanical engineer, a chemist, you name it. And they all, despite their high education, they work in Cargill, and as they call it, we cut meat. The reason is that they, and that is true about Ellen and her husband, they come with lottery visa. That is how they end up in Beerstown. Since 2001, United States established this, what they call it, diversity visa, to bring populations from places that have are underrepresented in US. So Togolese are having a quota, and they call it playing lottery, because they put their information in, and if their name is there, then they would be basically getting a visa. But what happens that they have 6 months to bring the entire family and take advantage of the visa, otherwise they cannot reactivate, I mean, use it. And for each single person to be able to move from West Africa to here, pay the fees, get the medical, you know, documentations, airline ticket, it's at least $3,500 or so. So for a family of four to get on the other side of border, it is really a huge sum of money, $15,000 or more. And for workers in Togolese payments, that, you know, a public service employee, oh, 2 minutes. Okay. So sorry about that. And it's a very different population. So forget about the student stories. This is the survey information. Education of Hispanics is 14%, that are college education or more. West Africans are 54%. And also the ability to bring their families. West Africans mostly leave their part of their families behind for the reason that I just said, they can't afford to bring everybody in. So for those families who have children, 84% of Hispanics are able to have their families, they have all their children with them. For West Africans, only 1/3 of them, of those who have children, have their children with them in Beerstown. And that is really, that becomes the chain that slaves them to Cargill, because they can't leave. They have to hold a job that they can save and send money home. They don't know the language, so despite their higher education, they have, you know, this is the second wave that came in 2003. So there have very different recent histories of migration to US and pre-existing institutions and networks of support in the United States. The two migrant groups have very different realities and experiences in Beerstown. This is just alluding to the racialized local history of sundown towns, and in Beerstown as one of those that had one black person in 1970, and now it's, as I mentioned, 35% or higher are non-whites. We have to remember absence of public or private social services in Beerstown, so these people arrive to a community where it has no preparation of how to receive them. There is no NGO, no social structure, social institutions there to receive them. And that's really, and the formal politics is a CEO-style kind of operation by the mayor. There is the local council, they're all English-speaking and white populations. I want to just flag in 1 minute, 1996 turmoil, where a 6-foot-tall cross was burnt in the middle of the town and the plaza as a protest against the diverse populations that were arriving there. That at the time in 1996, there were only Latin Americans, predominantly Mexicans. West Africans arrived only in 2003 later. And Cargill, because they didn't want to have more turmoil like what happened in 1996, after they burned the cross, there was a KKK march in the town and intimidation of the Mexicans. FBI came in and said, these are from other places, they are not from Beerstown. So it has been a very, very difficult history. So Cargill created a divided geography. They sent the West African workers to the town adjacent to make sure they don't mix, both from the labor point of view. We know all these theories of fragmentation of labor, how it benefits capitalism and plants, corporations, but also they didn't want to have to rock the boat again. So they said the African Americans were always segregated, living somewhere else. Mexicans as honorary whites were introduced to the community, but wasn't taken well, and then West Africans were sent to a third location. So this was a divided, racialized geography that Cargill created in 2003, but bottom of the line for my last 1 minute is that immigrants, through their agencies and through their own everyday practices, have been able to build relationships with each other between Mexicans and Togolese or Latin Americans and West Africans through soccer games and soccer teams, through childcare services, like the example that I said. What childcare did for women in terms of interracial dynamics and understandings, soccer teams were doing for men in terms of creating a space that would accommodate understanding. Residential integration has been the case. The immigrants are all over Beerstown because they didn't have planners that would segregate, that would create zones of, you know, how to zone them, zone, you know, poorer population out. And because they were sundown towns, they didn't have any, they had zoned out all the diverse population, so they really didn't need to have a zoning in place to separate into ethnic neighborhoods. And therefore, when the rapid rush of these diverse populations came, they are all over place, as they say it. They are mobile homes, as you can see, next to the houses, and they're all. And Mexicans became homeowners. They started making rental property available. And that is when, at the point in which West Africans started to move to Beerstown, they said, the hell with, you know, Cargill's sending us from somewhere else. Why should we drive 15 minutes at the end of the night shift, 1 a.m., to go home, so they started renting houses from properties from Mexicans, and Mexicans are now doing, you know, interracial landlords, and relationships are built that way too. So what, bottom line, what I want to say, the kind of separations and relationships that on the production floor was being imposed by corporation, immigrants outside the production floor have been able to renegotiate and find a relationship between with each other. Whites have also, and institutions, some institutions have been very important. After the 1996 KKK and cross burning, whites also didn't stay. You know, they realized they can't be neutral. They have to either be on the side of advocating, or, you know, one way or other, they can't just be on the fence. And therefore, they also mobilize in helping, and through churches and through schools that have been phenomenal in helping out with greater understanding. So I want to just go into, can I get one more minute or two more minutes? Is that okay? I just need to, sorry about that. To capture the complexity of immigrants' experiences in communities of their destination, we need to recognize the temporal, social, and spatial specificities of their experiences. This is determined not only by the characteristics of immigrants' communities of destination, for example, large metropolitan centers versus small towns, a point that I have discussed elsewhere, but also among immigrant communities in a small local context and racialized local history. Immigration is experienced differently by groups within the same locality based on the variations in their local and translocal networks and resources, and also by groups' immigration and racial histories. In case of Beerstown, for example, Latinos have a longer tradition of immigration, and they basically behave very differently from West Africans. West Africans do not have that network across the country that they could know, how do I become a homeowner, and etc. So they kind of have different realities in that sense. I skipped that. Secondly, this leads us to my second point on relationality of immigrants' agency. Just as it is inadequate to generalize the experience of one immigrant group to another, to capture the agency of immigrant groups in a new community of destination, it is inadequate to focus on the interracial dynamics between one single immigrant group vis-a-vis the dominant native born residents. In this case, for example, examining the interracial dynamics between those, for example, between Mexicans and local English-speaking white residents, would not have revealed the full picture of the processes and practices through which the new socio-spatial relations have been renegotiated in this town. Right? Often we take one immigrant group and we see, examine their relationship with the dominant population, and we don't capture the force and power that they gain by interracial relationships amongst various immigrant groups. It is through solidarities developed not only between white local residents and Mexicans, but also across immigrant groups between Mexicans and West Africans, that many aspects of inclusivity in public institutions and public space have been achieved. Diverse immigrant groups jointly and in relation to each other, based on complementarities of their resources and constraints, have gained a stronger possibility to renegotiate their experiences in Beerstown. For example, in respect to housing that I mentioned, they needed house that the other group was homeowners, so they kind of helped to challenge the geography that Cargill had set in place. Thirdly, and the last point, is that racialized and immigration histories of the receiving communities, in this case Beerstown, as a former sundown town constituted by white European immigrants, and those of incoming groups, in this case Mexican and West Africans, are crucial in understanding the emerging dynamics of immigration in these communities. In a context like Beerstown, where a strong racist history, with a strong racist history, Hispanics in relation to black West Africans are considered more tolerable. Some might say they can pass as honorary whites in some racist contexts. The divided geography that the corporation initiated by settling West Africans elsewhere is an important indication of how immigration and race work in tangent with each other and are entangled in constituting the experiences of immigrant groups. hence to capture the interracial dynamics that emerge in these new destinations among immigrants and between immigrants and established residents who have little experience with diversity. We need to examine these processes and dynamics in the intersection, or at the intersection of race and immigration. To summarize, this is the last paragraph. It would be a grave mistake for urban studies concerned with transnational urban processes and immigrants' urban experiences to conflate the various immigrant groups into one single category of the immigrant. As any attempt to understand the processes by which immigrants claim the new towns as their home and assert their right to the cities and neighborhoods they move to must consider the specificities of local and translocal resources, networks, and histories of a particular group in a particular local context and particular time. It also needs to consider the interracial and intergroup dynamics in new destinations among immigrants. Spatial and temporal variations of immigration, immigrants' experiences within the same linguistic, cultural, and national group, as well as across immigrant groups, matter greatly to how they develop interracial relationships vis-a-vis native-born populations. Yet more, through the interracial dynamics that they have forged outside the workplace and within their residential communities, immigrants have been able to renegotiate spatial relations that a domineering I can't read my own handwriting. that a domineering focusing on one group, the domineering group or corporate institution set in place that they cannot capture. Together, the two groups have been able to make a different meaning for their immigration to this local community in the heartland. Sorry for rushing through this. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you, Faranak. And we will hear our last presentation for this panel from Marcela Tovar.
Good afternoon. My topic has to do with nations within nations, transnationalism, and indigenous citizenship in Latin America. Over the last three decades in Latin America, indigenous movements have played key roles in revisioning democratic processes from local to global horizons. From Chile to Mexico, transnational citizenship projects have emerged contesting not only foundational national state tropes, but also conventional isomorphism established between place, space, and culture. Claiming a special citizenship rights, these initiatives have exceeded nation state boundaries, deploying different strategies to produce new forms of gender and cultural difference. Such strategies have required the flexible and transnational mobility of these peoples between historically interconnected local, regional, and global spaces. Local communities, national states, NGOs, regional and international movements have been crucial sites where indigenous peoples have negotiated issues of identity, established different alliances, and posed new political, cultural, and gender geographies. I argue that the production of new forms of gender and ethnicity are constructed through transnational strategies in which liminality enables the emergence of new political identities and redefinition of citizenship. By examining such strategies, I will focus on how these processes have forced us to rethink the politics of space, community, identity, and citizenship in Latin America. For that purpose, I examine national constitutions and international agreements as key locus, that illustrate how transnational imaginary significations related to identity and citizenship have traveled from local to global spheres, making possible the recognition of indigenous rights. So I would like to start by recalling how early nation state projects in Latin America during the 19th century were founded upon exclusionary systems of racial and gender categorization. What can be seen as transnational Eurocentric imaginary significations of gender and ethnicity informed early constitutions in our countries. The Spanish Cadiz Constitution from 1812 inspired many of our early constitutions in Latin America. Here, these are some of the early constitutions that actually incorporated many of the principles stated in that Cadiz Spanish Constitution. You'll see the dates of some of these early constitutions. Basically, as we all know, here indigenous peoples were considered as minors or disabled peoples, actually stated like that in many constitutions, who should be civilized or converted to Catholicism. The constitution in Colombia from 1886 actually named them minors or idiots, and that goes through many of these constitutions. Furthermore, all early constitutions in Latin America shared common issues in relation to indigenous peoples, such as subsuming indigenous territories into national boundaries, denying recognition to traditional authorities, and ignoring the legal status of treaties established between indigenous peoples and the Spanish crown. Such is the case of the Chilean Constitution in 1822, which did not admit and denied the existence of the Mapuche nation that was recognized by the Spaniards during the conquest. I think that this point is not actually debatable, and I don't need to remind the audience here that there were many different forms of oppression suffered by indigenous peoples that were consigned in the colonial body laws. However, it is important to remember that all ideas of nationhood and citizenship are not only about blunt impositions, but about contested and negotiated processes. It is possible to see in some of these constitutions in Latin America that forms of resistance of indigenous peoples also were consecrated in some of the constitutions. That is the case, for example, of the resguardos indígenas or cabildos indígenas that were introduced in some constitutions, like in the one in Colombia, and those were forms of communal property granted to indigenous peoples where there was allowed traditional land management or traditional practices. Furthermore, as products of this indigenous resistance, some small changes were introduced in constitutions during the 19th in some of our countries, like the Mexican Constitution in 1917 in relation to land issues, the Constitution in Peru in 1920, the Constitution in Bolivia in 1938. However, it is also clear that the philosophy the constitutional philosophy regarding indigenous peoples in the region remain almost intact until recently. That is the case, for example, of Ecuador and Peru, that is still in 1978 and 1979, indigenous peoples still were regarded as subjects that should be taken care of, but rather than subjects of rights. Now let's talk about recent emerging projects of citizenship in the region, which have actually become more and more present in Latin America since the 1980s. Here, transnational scenarios and sites like international NGOs and international rights platforms have triggered much of this political and cultural debate. I'm going to name quickly some of them. There are widely known treaties and platforms of rights, such as the ILO Convention 169, the Permanent Indigenous Forum and the UN, the International Indigenous Women Forum in 2000, the Cumbre Continental de los Pueblos y Nacionalidades Indígenas Abya-Yala in 2004, and the Universal Declaration of Indigenous Peoples' Rights from 2007, actually very recent. These are some other platforms that have triggered much of this debate. The main demands, I would say, that are incorporated in these emergent citizenship projects in Latin America carried out by indigenous peoples have to do with autodetermination of peoples, territoriality, use of natural resources, political representation, language diversity, and special jurisdictional systems. As discussed below, many of these rights have been recognized in different constitutions in many countries, creating a political and legal new precedent for the first time in history in the region. Given its qualitative characteristics, and it is especially important the creation of new collective platforms of indigenous women, it is not until very recently that indigenous women have publicly assumed and vindicated their own and political space as women. Indigenous women have to negotiate their gender interest within what is regarded as a tension with their own people's interest. Because of patriarchal forms present in indigenous peoples and movements, vindications of indigenous women can be seen as contrary to cultural vindications of traditional indigenous practices. For this reason, indigenous women's local, regional, and global organizations are very few and extremely recent. These are some of the ones that have started to emerge. The first one is an international platform. The second one deals with a regional platform. There are also some organizations coming up in countries like Peru, Colombia, Ecuador, Bolivia, etc. All these platforms, products of local and global struggles carried out by indigenous peoples have provoked changes in national constitutions. Let's see what has happened during the 90s. Very quickly, all these constitutions have introduced changes that whether expand already recognized rights or actually start recognizing rights of indigenous peoples. We can see that it goes from the 80s actually into 2009. The way international platforms have influenced the inclusion of indigenous peoples' rights in constitutions reveal that these movements have performed effective strategies to build alliances and to cross and create new borders between interconnected spaces. Both diachronic and synchronic perspectives over constitutional inclusion and exclusion of indigenous peoples show how processes of creation of sameness and difference have taken place between localities, regions, and international instances. So the question here are, what are the new constructions of gender and ethnicity that are at stake in these processes, and how can we explain these strategies that indigenous peoples have carried out in order to have some of the rights included in constitutions? Postcolonial theory has elaborated extensively on these issues. It places a special emphasis on anti-essentialist constructions of ethnic identities who are mapping cultures and as discrete phenomena that occupy bounded spaces is problematic and unrealistic. Here the question is not so much about static power relations, about unified and monolithic cultural entities that reproduce a radical separation between us and them. On the contrary, the question must refer to the process of production of ethnic difference within interdependent and interconnected spaces where border zones within and between communities are drawn and rights are differently granted. In this sense, it can be said that ethnicity and ethnic difference are fluid and are produced in the course of economic, political, and cultural struggles, becoming in this way central issues for hegemonic processes. This recalls Gramsci's notion of hegemony, defined as a result of continuous struggles and negotiation processes in which, in the case of Latin America, ethnicity is a crucial marker when analyzing nation states, difference, and citizenship. In effect, indigenous movements in Latin America have put into question the totalizing dimension of the state, as well as notions of national character or national identity based on static ethnic tropes. Rather than a finished, homogeneous, unarticulated project, state hegemony is a problematic and disputed process which has to be renewed, recreated, and modified as the Latin American history makes it evident. On this note, more questions arise. To what extent then do indigenous peoples accept, reformulate, reject, or participate in these hegemonic processes within these conflictive national state arenas? What is the role of local, regional, and global instances and the role of the actors that play into this process? In order to answer this question, I have defined difference, or cultural difference if you want, as an inclusion and exclusion device in state-making processes, especially when referring to constitutional rights. In other words, I see the notion of difference working as a device that is operated to include or exclude, to grant rights or to deny them. It is especially interesting how indigenous peoples and indigenous movements are especially aware of this kind of device and how they use it when facing rights recognitions processes. Articulation theory and Turner's concept of liminality throw light on these questions. They speak about the articulation ability of cultural groups to persist and survive by constantly reconfiguring themselves, by being made, unmade, and remade, depending on conjunctural socio-political context and situations. They refer to mobile strategies through which cultural collectives establish alliances and generate processes of sameness or difference in order to configure an identity and produce a political deed. Articulation evokes a sense of the political where productive processes of consensus, exclusions, alliance, and antagonism are inherent in the changing life of all societies. Here, the question of authenticity of cultural formations is secondary. And primarily, here, what matters is the struggle for preservation, which is entirely political. Spivak calls these essentialist strategies. She sees the political role of strategic essentialism as to enable oppressed social groups like ethnic minorities or women to present themselves as a solid identity and pose political demands. By bonding indifference in specific moments, scenarios, or political platforms, these social collectives claim and vindicate rights recognitions that are of common interest. Without distinguishing internal differences, these groups use this bondage to briefly create a common identity to be played out on specific political situations. These moments of production of sameness or communalities might be contingent, though no less real, less legitimate, or less genuine because of that. The fact that a certain cultural homogenization is accepted under the category of indigenous peoples without making visible diversity and political disputes among them is the product of this usage. As an example, it is possible to quote the case of the National Constitutional Assembly in Colombia in 1991, when for the first time indigenous peoples participated in a democratic instance representing their own interests. Colombia has 82 different ethnic groups who speak 64 different languages and have great differences among them. Peoples self-identified as Arhuacos or Huambianos would make evident the paradoxical fact of having imposed on themselves different identity categories such as indigenous peoples or Colombians in order to have their rights recognized. They would argue that those categories, being Colombians or being indigenous peoples, would not mean or add anything to their own self-conception. Yet, they were aware of the tactical use of such reference in order to conceal and institute the political deed of being included in the Constitution under such categories. It is also possible to see this performed on the international level, when diverse peoples from all over the world come together and demand or institute political international platforms like the UN Declaration of Rights of Indigenous Peoples or the UN Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues. Here you find self-identified groups that do not share any cultural content, for example, the sons of the Anaconda from the Amazons compared to the Maasai from Kenya, sharing same exact demands. These strategies can also be defined as liminal states. Liminality is defined as a state of flux that emerges at a particular stage in a temporal process of a community. This refers to the movement of a community from one normative stage to another. It is a transnational state where a transitional state where normal cultural patterns might be suspended and formations of alliances might be done within this new liminal space. In other words, liminality describes a transitional state that comprises the boundary between different communities and allows temporary movements between them or among them. Turner observes how at such times a sense of communitas overcomes the community, resulting in practices that may subvert its normal forms. However, although the liminal may go against order and against regular structures, it has the potential to form new and different structures. It can be empowering and induce new positive social changes. In Turner's view, these liminal stages are vital for communities to ensure their subsistence by being at once transgressive and enduring, ambiguous and certain, changeable and stable. Paradoxically, in these stages, indigenous peoples must momentarily rescind their own traditional identity in order to guarantee it. They must stop being the people of and become part of a different identitary body labeled as a homogeneous collective that deserve the same rights. As we have presented it here, in the case of Latin America, these contingent strategies have resulted in new identitary forms expressed in novel definitions of citizenship related to ethnicity that have been consigned in different constitutions. Simultaneously, it can be said that by expanding and opening up notions of citizenship, new gender and ethnic identities are being produced, reproduced at local and global levels. In other words, acquiring new rights has enabled new identity forms. Such is the case of indigenous women who are progressively playing new roles in their communities and at the regional level, in the case of Latin America, as political leaders who form their own organizations and rights platforms. Indigenous citizenship projects in Latin America can be seen in perspective as transnational, local, and global processes that involve the active production of ethnic sameness and difference through diverse political and liminal strategies in the context of nation states. They can be understood as attempts at autonomy that still need much deliberation and the creation of new institutions and political identities, but they can be considered as seeds and expressions of social instituting power of their own societies and their own capacity to self-generate new forms, new social forms. These projects have a long way to go, but despite the incompleteness and the lack of effective implementation of rights in many Latin American countries, because that's in fact is the case, these processes must be developed in a peaceful manner as many and most indigenous peoples have pursued them in the region, rather than secessionist or dangerous social manifestations as they are still regarded by many states in the region. For example, last week, president from Ecuador was calling indigenous peoples and their movement as a secessionist movement. So it is a repetitive figure that comes up every time in Latin America. These projects must be advanced in order to deepen modern democracies. Avoiding essentialist concepts of sex, gender identity, and ethnic difference that falls into ideas of purity, of pristine order, or even unrealistic expectations of what can be achieved within the global context, fully participatory rights should be granted to indigenous men and women. This implies the legal recognition of indigenous territorial administrative units, recognition of traditional authorities, devolution of fiscal resources and national rents, national and local gender balanced participation in decision-making instances, and full participation and previous consent in natural resources management. Those are minimal conditions to advance citizenship rights projects in the region. I hope I'm in time. I'm in time. Okay. Thank you.
I think this was an exceptional group of papers, and I'm actually going to try to shorten my comments so that we could really open it up to a dialogue, I think, with the audience, because I think these papers would be a wonderful kind of platform, I think, to discuss a larger set of issues for the conference. So I think this rich and compelling research, I think through these fascinating case studies and theories, demonstrates to us how identities, collective and individual, are sustained and contested, challenged and reshaped by complex spatializing vectors at play within the transnational networks through which groups move from place to place. And so my specific questions to each of you, I think, will delve into the issues of gender and ethno-race, which I think are critical to the way in which the panel is framed, but I also think that there are issues around sexuality and also class that are embedded, I think, in a lot of the things that these papers also bring up. I also think it's important to recognize that all of these papers, I think, do a really wonderful job of, I think, atomizing that monolithic category of immigrant, so that we might recognize the sort of complex affiliations that are really working through these various communities and localities that I think our panel are researching. And I think it's really important to recognize how these identities intersect with the material conditions that in fact shape the spaces of uneven economic and social relations that the papers also interrogate. So, Gerardo, I think your research on rural towns in the Midwest, I think brilliantly reworks and expands Smith's definition, which I was not familiar with, but I was glad you included that quote of his transnationalism, which he defines as ways that social actors connect to social economic opportunities, political structures, and cultural practices found in cities. And I think you rightly suggest that those processes also circulate through small towns like Perry and Postville, transforming them indeed into global spaces and linking them to towns and regions of Guatemala, Mexico, and elsewhere. I would also add that Smith makes a curious split between city and country. I mean, I think it's interesting that he describes it as a city that really overlooks how processes of urbanization have always incorporated rural areas into the global circuits of people, resources, finances, and et cetera. And so to that question of circuits, I wonder how the transnational flows of monies, peoples, and culture offered in your text and shown in your slides are really also about this kind of interwoven, intersecting, severed, knotted, and extensive complex set of relationships. And in that regard, I'm wondering how you might begin to actually map those circuits. You know, because I think you showed that really great slide that basically had that vector between those places. But I'm wondering, given your both pedagogical interest, how these circuits of families, monies, jobs, wages, profits, and goods might benefit from a kind of visualization of those transnational flows, especially charting their change over time, because you're also documenting a kind of moment of rupture in those flows. And I think these will further complicate Smith's emphasis on the city and demonstrate the rising significance of these rural towns. And I also obviously think they're really useful parallels in what you're talking about, clearly with what Faranek had also talked about. I think Zaida's research wonderfully parallels also Faranek's analysis in regards to how particular groups of women from and immigrants from Africa and also parts of Latin America connect to very, very different networks and histories of transnational movement. I think your meticulous case studies of the public plazas in Barcelona's housing projects illustrate for us how gender and social class influence affect the use of public space by immigrant women. And that women also bear the brunt of poor housing conditions. And I think you also point to a really, really critical point, is that female migration as a worldwide phenomenon is indicative of the feminization of poverty. And I think that's a really, really critical point that I think could be worked through the number of papers as well. So one of your goals is to develop policies to assist in the integration and the autonomy of women without reinforcing these stereotypes. And if so, are there social movements already forming amongst these groups of women that you've actually have been studying in order to enact change and thereby open that door of invisibility that you described? If these public plazas are not yet public spaces in the sense of spheres of political contestation, based upon your research, is the domestic sphere and the networks connected to these domestic spaces for these women becoming current or more speculatively a potential site for political activism? So in what ways might these domestic spheres that you're talking about, these women actually occupying, that may not move into the kind of more traditional public spaces, becoming perhaps sites of political contestation and formation of social movements in order to argue for rights of women? And I think, Farinet, you make the provocative and important conclusion that, quote, immigrant is experienced differently within the same locality based on the variations of their local and transnational networks and resources in immigration and racial histories. I would like to hear you elaborate further on how these new immigrants are indeed confronting older, what I would call ethno-racial formations, of these particular places. And I think you describe them as, you know, this term of sundown towns, that are really about this particular area. But by ethno-racial formations, I mean that racial violence and threats are also a consequence and a product of these earlier migrations of both European immigrants who have earned, in Roediger's sense, their wages of whiteness. But this is a consequence of how they competed for jobs and resources and homes with black southern migrants, so migrants moving from the south, moving into these regions, in the earlier 20th century. I wanted to know more also about how West African and African American workers construct relationships, as I think Tovar presents, of sameness and difference around work and access to resources. And I would also love to hear more about the economies of labor, and I think you alluded this more, I think, in your presentation than in the paper I read, around the economies of labor and the social formations of relationships across immigrant groups outside of the factory floors. And I feel like the last part of your presentation really started to illustrate how, you know, soccer teams and childcare start to bring together, I think, new relationships that are somehow outside of the control of the corporation. Okay, and then for Marcela, I think the sort of question of agency, I think, is critical in your work. And I think you want us to see that indigenous citizenship projects in Latin America as both transnational, local, and global processes, and this is to quote you, that involve the active production of ethnic sameness and difference across political, and I love this the notion of liminal strategies in the context of nation states. So as a cultural historian, and that's sort of my, as well as an architect, but as a cultural historian, I greatly appreciate your history of indigenous peoples within the formation of the nation states of Latin America. I would also suggest that it is critical to recognize that what we now distinguish as clearly separate sort of racial, ethnic, and national identities were often elided in 19th and 20th century notions of citizenship and national belonging. Not only, let's say, racial and national identities perhaps not separated, but they were also spatialized in the representational spheres of the foreboding, uncivilized jungle or the primitive villages. Within which you find indigenous people and enslaved Africans, and that was considered below the cultural sphere of the enlightened city. Right? And so I think that's how this kind of ideas of citizenship spatialized themselves historically, and that nation and race and ethnicity were all essentially compacted within those descriptions. And I think, as you rightly point out, that citizenship is an identity that is configured through the play of sameness and difference to produce indeed a political action. So I was curious if you could elaborate further on how indigenous groups have utilized new media as ways of forming critical transnational linkages and allegiances globally, and have this virtual space been utilized as a critical middle ground or a liminal space, as you describe it, through which to articulate particular local claims as well as transnational imaginaries. And I think one of my questions to the group as a whole is to maybe unpack the question of sexuality actually within it, because I think this category of the women with bracelets, the Latin American single mother in Barcelona, also the indigenous women, which I'm wondering to the degree to which they see themselves also as mothers, right? So that these kind of sexual, the categories of sex really work against the kind of patriarchal state as well, which could also be read against gender, race, and class positions. So those are my specific and sort of general questions to the panel, and I would love to have the panel come up and respond briefly to, I think, to my questions, and then I'd like to open it out to the audience. So please. Because the panel is also about gender, ethno, race, but also how that intersects, I think, as well with class and sexualized identities in this transnational.
Someone wants to share? I can answer. As I understand the question you mark upon my presentation, obviously, it shows the feminization of poverty. It's really a big deal. And if I understand your question, you ask me if this public space could be a potential space for political contestation for the women? Mm-hmm. I think no in this case, because it's very related to the reproductive task. It's not, and also because the neighborhood is a very apart one, it's not the central part of the city, mm-hmm. So if they make any kind of political contestation there, it has not any impact in the city. And I think that in the case of the two groups, the Muslim women, they deal with, well, I'm going to say more, but not more, but different problems than the Latin American. One is the language, and that they were really perpresas, they are really attached to, to their own community because of the language. And in this neighborhood, there is a school of Spanish for foreigners in a school during school hours for these women. And I think that this is a good thing for them to go there because they began to build a different network with the teacher, but people from there, and they began to know the language. But they have the problem of the division of labor in the interior of their family. And the Latin America, there are some groups in Barcelona and Catalonia that political groups in base movement that are formed by women, immigrant women, most part of them Latin American women. It's not the case of this neighborhood, and also because, again, because of the poverty of the situation of these women, I think they have no time.
Yeah.
and also they work in another neighborhood, or cleaning or taking care of people. So they have no time, and they have to also to take care of their families that are in Peru, in Ecuador, in Brazil, Dominicana, the main groups. So I think that they have time and they have public spaces to do political contestations. And well, it's another case, but in the other neighborhood we analyze is a neighborhood that had been renewal under a law that I have no time to explain that. But in that neighborhood, it's an up-down organization, but the municipal government create a kind of network between the immigrant women to work and to improve the neighborhood, and also to create links between the women and to give voice to them. And in this case, I think that the renewal of the neighborhood make visible the women task and the women needs. It's just a step forward.
Sir, can I ask a question? No, I really have the same exact question as Mabel, because in your presentation, one kind of appreciate that what you have found is that the use of public space actually reiterates or reaffirms traditional gender roles. Yeah. And so I wanted to ask you, in your project, did you pose the question of how would you actually make the transition into possibilities of different public space usage that would enable more or a different gender roles or empowering women in terms of political spheres or political roles?
Not in the work, but in this work, but with another group, we work with the women groups, mm-hmm. basic women groups, and from these works and trying to take things from the base groups, from the women in the street, trying to know what they need, what they want, and trying to transform this in mm-hmm. a kind of program for new public spaces, of program for facilities, but not from this mm-hmm. this project.
Well, I haven't actually studied systematically the gender dimensions of this project. It would have been another very interesting, I should have asked questions or observations about when, you know, I mean, I have anecdotes that really triggered my interest. And for example, one of the West African women, she had maids and she had cook at home and chauffeur because she was an educated, you know, higher class in West Africa. Coming here, she was working night shift with her husband. So, but she was still, and she said, for the first time in my life, I'm cooking, you know. So how does, when you get transplanted to another context, that your class, social class changes, and does that affect your performance of gender roles, and how is that mm-hmm. renegotiated in the new context, could be another project mm-hmm. that I didn't go there. But I think it is a very important question to be explored. So I could speak more to your question about the relationship between whites and, you know, who were earning wages of whiteness, and when the, you know, first wave of immigrant workers, Mexicans, arrive, and also relationship between African Americans and West Africans. That is very much true that when the first wave of immigrants, the Mexicans arrived, it was seen as basically Mexicans breaking the picket line, because it was after a long process of union negotiation in the 1980s that before Cargill was Oscar Mayer, another company that owned the plant, and Oscar Mayer shut down because said, oh, this workers are white workers that have seniority, they are asking too much for their wages and union is too strong. They threatened and then they shut the plant down. And after they shut it down, Cargill bought it and brought in immigrants with immediately bringing down the entry level wages $2 lower. So the white workers didn't want to work for $2 lower than what they were getting, and plus losing their seniority, everybody had to start from beginning. And that translated into a lot of racial hatred and violence that later in, you know, 3 years down the road kind of broke out in 1996 events. In respect to West Africans, was interesting because they were also placed in another sundown town. I mean, they weren't placed in a town that was more tolerant of blacks. I mean, Rushville, the adjacent town, also has a history of sundown town. But every time I spoke to whites, they would refer to West Africans as an interesting use of "but" that we often see. They are black, but they are nice people. They are black, but they are different. You know. So and you could see that how they were saying they are black, but and they were saying they are black, but they speak French. They are black, but they are educated. You know. And so they were constructed really as we were surprising the local community that they were different, and in their construction of whatever they had seen African Americans, these West Africans, by not speaking English or having a French accent, which is very exotic, and you know they were constructed as these are the good ones we can keep, and therefore the West Africans I interviewed, I expected to hear from them stories of violence and, you know, rejection, and they kept saying, no, people have been nice to us. And one of them was saying, oh, any complaint, you know, he had was that the first when he arrived in his mobile home every half an hour after the shift, you know, he worked morning shift, so that I was waking up because somebody was knocking at my mobile home trying to give me cookie, muffin, you know, something, you know, offering. And I think that had also to do with that mobilized whites, that they were really so scared of seeing blacks amongst them, and they were acting over, you know, on the other side, bending backward, trying to accommodate the new group. So the relationship between them is that really because African Americans never moved to Beerstown, even after it became a diverse place, because they have the collective memory of the history of the place. And ignorance, in a way, is a bliss for the West Africans, that they didn't know what, I mean, they would have a Confederation flag hanging right in front of them, you know, in their neighboring house, that a lot of them do still put their Confederation flag, and they wouldn't know what that symbolizes, right? So African Americans never moved back, and that kind of hasn't allowed relationship between them outside the workplace. So that is basically what I could say about that side.
Actually, in time, why don't we open it up to the audience? I think that's a question. Yes, I have a question about Beerstown and the child caring network that you were talking about. And I was wondering how formalized that is, and is there advertisements or is it all word of mouth? And who's primarily taking care of the children? And you're talking a lot about nighttime shifts, and is it happening during then? And I just would like to hear more about that whole.
It's informal. It's informal. It's no formal, and there's no advertisement. Most of the Mexican population are not documented, so it's all under the table kind of exchanges, and word of mouth. And they would, the ones that work on the line, they would know that, you know, oh, you need childcare, you know, my cousin could do, my mother-in-law could do. And what was the other question? Oh, and a lot of the husband and wives, they try to, one of them work morning shift, the other one evening shift, so that they can, you know, have less dependent on childcare, but still that there is an hour in between. Those who arrange it that way, then they still would have an hour between this one going and the other one coming home that they will need childcare. So sometimes they resolve it that way, and other times they will have a full-time childcare by using the network of Mexicans. So, but that is all informal, it's not a formal arrangement.
The exchanges across racial boundaries. It seems that the conditions of the town or some of the framing like the sundown and the turmoil of the 96 puts a lot of pressure in terms of the divides. But you also talk about how suddenly through childcare or through sports, there are spaces, public spaces of exchange. Can you explain that a little bit more? It's, if you were not given a few of those examples, it would be hard to think that there is some exchange across these very different groups, a local-wide, more ingrained Latino population and a more recent West African population.
What are the spaces of?
How are those spaces created? How do they look like? How are they produced?
Well, soccer is something, again, because the Latin Americans, which predominantly are Mexicans, are an older group. They are much better, you know, they know much better how to move around and what to do and how to basically what. I write about it in the text is longer. Asif Bayat talks about quiet encroachment, you know, of the ordinary, right? And I think in places like Beerstown, where you cannot have a collective movement, you know, it just is not possible. Cargill is the only company; it has its, you know, power and claws everywhere. So there, really, you have this quiet encroachment. You have the approach which is non-collective movement, and it's you cannot raise a committee that people come together and say, you know, no, we have the right of using the space, and why is police racial profiling, which are the realities. So they do it through other means. And I think the role of whites have been, and the institutions like churches, schools, have been very important. So school has been another site that I didn't talk about it. They basically have a teachers movement that they went door to door and got approval of white English-speaking parents and also Spanish-speaking parents to adopt a program called Dual Language Program, which 50% of every curriculum item is offered in Spanish and the other 50% in English. So these white kids went home to their family with half of their math or science exercise or assignment in the Spanish language. But for that, the teachers had to take the time of a summer every evening going door to door and convince parents. So it was a lot of that kind of work to build, you know, from teachers built it, churches contributed, and also then the individuals through landlords or, you know, rental or soccer, etc. So it's kind of, it's a different mode of operation than what you have in big cities, that you march in Chicago against immigration. In Beerstown, they couldn't do that. They did it very differently.
Thank you all. That was a very interesting panel. And I agree with Mabel that the question of sexuality and kind of gender analysis dropped out and may enrich in some of the presentations. And Gerardo, I loved your presentation. I think it's really wonderful, all the things you're doing in terms of the transnational migrations and looking at all those circuits. But I was interested, especially because in popular culture, we're seeing so much cinematically, you know, this kind of rise of attention to the female migrant and non-normative sexualities, and specifically the mother in her kind of trying to attenuate this distance through technologies like, you know, the phone, et cetera, and trying to actually be a mother from afar sometimes. And also the homosocial spaces that are often created when men leave. I mean, I know you talked about both men and women working in the meat packing industry. So I was just wondering, how would you bring gender and kind of the question of sexuality, just pushing on this question even further, into your kind of subsequent methodology, because I realize it's an ongoing project.
So. Yeah, no, definitely. And that kind of relates to the question that you asked me about my method. So yeah, the next kind of level that I want to take this to is kind of mapping out the different economic and social and kind of cultural and kind of gender aspects of both spaces. And I think what makes Postville really unique is the fact that it's such a confined space, and there was this, you mentioned this rupture aspect of it, right? That I think I can measure these things. And so far I've started a lot with kind of the economic measures, the remittances and so forth. In terms of the gender aspects, I'm starting with the Postville case just because it's so kind of politically dynamic, right? And it's and the women there have really used this notion of being mothers and having to kind of protect their kids as a unifying political unifying type of method for political reasons and just to get more empowerment. In terms of the Guatemalan aspect of it, most of them are cachiquel, Mayan indigenous women that came from these villages. And so what happened there was that at first the husbands immigrated to Postville, and they stayed behind. Then that's when they started kind of getting into more of the workforce and so forth. And once the husbands started settling down in Postville, that's when they made the migration up to Postville. Right. So some of the key things I want to go back and analyze. It's just that transition, what did that transition kind of mean to, like the power dynamics and within the villages themselves back in Guatemala, and how did that change, after they immigrated to Postville, and some of the connections that they were able to maintain within both of the spaces. So
this is a very interesting conversation. We'll take the comments or the questions if they are very brief, but we will have to stop here because we're running late. We will have to even shorten the break. Instead of having a 30-minute break, we reconvene at 4:05 here, a 20-minute break instead, because there is a musician coming at 6, and I think he's playing whether we're there or not, so we need to catch up. So let's hear the comments very quickly, please.
Or what kind of journey they have to go through to reach those places. And when I started to think about that, I just remembered that incident that happened once in the metro of Barcelona, this Catalonian skinhead attacking brutally this teenage girl from Ecuador, I believe. So, and how would the management, the social management of safety in those areas would be part of this policies that you're proposing for making these spaces more welcoming and enabling to these populations?
Could you pass the microphone
now,
please?
Hi. Hello. I have a question in the different multicultural ethnic groups that have come to the United States. I mean, Guatemala is a place of Cachiquel, Quechi, and Quiche people. And also Mexico has very much its different cultures. And I wanted to know if any research has been made on how have they have done word of mouth, have they been coming in as groups, and how have they maintained their own traditions within the United States?
Let's take the conversation to the halls, please, as we make this break. Let's thank the speakers and Mabel again, please.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much.